All right, gang, I am off to the cinema this incredibly gloomy day to go check out The Fate of the Furious.
Dom!
Now, this is, of course, the eighth film in the ridiculously titled and impossibly long Fast and the Furious franchise.
I will beat your ass like a Cherokee drum.
And in this entry, Vin Diesel's Dominic Toretto, he goes rogue, he goes bad.
Dominic Toretto just went rogue.
You gonna turn your back on family?
This can't be happening, man. This isn't happening.
Question, will his fate be Fastly Furious? that makes no sense. You know what? I think the next logical progression for this film franchise, it's not space. It's surfing. Just think about it a bit. Alright, gang, I just got out of The Fate of the Furious.
Phase two.
Phase two? What's phase two?
Bounds away.
Holy s***!
Spoiler alert, this movie is only mildly fast and maybe just moderately furious.
I will beat your ass like a Cherokee drum.
Does that make sense? I think it does. It also might be the only movie in cinematic history that has The Rock deflecting a nuclear submarine's torpedo with his hands.
This is crazy!
You know, when I think back, way, way back, like 17 years to the very first Fast and Furious film, I mean, that was essentially a fairly modest and grounded street racing film. The Fate of the Furious is pure ludicrous science fiction compared to that film.
You thought this was going to be a street fight.
Can you actually believe that they have made eight of these movies? I mean, really just stop and think about that. Now,
this can't be happening, man. This isn't happening.
Here's my history, my take, I guess, on the series as a whole. I really enjoyed the first film, even though, yes, it is a blatant and obvious Point Break remake with cars. Minus Keanu Reeves. Insert Paul Walker in his place. I know. Too Fast, Too Furious, arguably one of the most forgettable sequels, maybe, of the last 20 years. Does anyone really remember anything from Too Fast, Too Furious? Then came Fast and the Furious Tokyo Drift, which pretty much didn't have any of the cast members from the first two films. When I saw that film at the end, I'm like, I think this is the nail in the coffin for this series. And then something miraculous happened. They did a fourth Fast and the Furious film, and they got back Paul Walker and Vin Diesel and most of the cast from the first two films. And then Fast 5 came out, and Fast 5, for my money, was the best film in the series, and maybe the best fifth film in movie history. I'm not afraid or ashamed to admit that. It really kind of just, you know, shook up the franchise really, really well, and it basically turned this street racing franchise and into a heist thriller franchise. So I really like that shake and break approach. It worked really, really well. To a certain extent, this was carried forward in Fast and Furious 6 and then Fast 7. And then, of course, this brings us to The Fate of the Furious. And the whole advertising campaign behind this film, especially in terms of its marketing, is that this is the one, wait for it, Dominic Toretto turns bad! He turns bad!
Did you ever think you'd betray your family the way you did today?
This can't be happening, man. This isn't happening.
So that's the basic crutch of The Fate of the Furious. I mean, if you want to get into more specific plot details, Dominic Toretto is basically coerced by this cyber terrorist played actually pretty well by Charlize Theron, who has dirt. Dirt on Dominic Toretto that is not initially revealed.
You ready?
One thing I can guarantee, no one's ready for this.
When it is revealed, it's like, really? That's what convinced him to turn bad and evil?
She's the very definition of high-tech terrorism. And now, she's working with your guy.
She has convinced him to turn against his family. That's a big no-no in Dominic Toretto's world. Turns on his family to help her steal, like, a nuclear bomb and nuclear launch keys and a submarine and the God's Eye from the previous film. And it's kind of like, my head's just spinning thinking about this movie.
You want to play like that?
Okay. Here's one thing I'll say about The Fate of the Furious. The Fate of the Furious, kind of like Fast Five, it's trying to reinvent itself with a lot less success, in the sense that they're setting up a potentially compelling plot angle where they take the main hero of the franchise, which is Vin Diesel's Dominic Toretto, and make him a bad guy.
No!
That's kind of a refreshing angle. I don't know of a lot of franchises that do that, but I mean, let's be honest. Does anyone going into this film, and I don't think I'm engaging in any spoilers in saying this, does anyone going into The Fate of the Furious honestly believe that the Fast and the Furious film franchise was going to take their hero and truly make him bad and evil?
Come on! Come on! Come on!
I think they missed a really glorious opportunity to really milk this plot angle for multiple films, and I think it's really dealt in a much too neat and tidy fashion in this one film. And I think there was a glorious opportunity missed to really go places with this franchise that it hasn't gone before. And I think that's what my favorite Fast and Furious film, Fast Five, did several years ago, that this film just simply doesn't do.
Let me ask you something, Dom. What's the best thing in your life?
Family.
No, it's not.
Of the things that I did like, I mean, I really like Charlize Theron. I think she injects a very menacing presence, a very low-key, understated, menacing presence to this film. And
it's the 10 seconds between start and finish when you're not thinking about anything. No family, no obligations, just you. Being free.
You know what? She has Now, she creates a lot of tension in her scenes with Vin Diesel, and I really like that. You know, the film's director is F. Gary Gray, and you know, he previously directed The Italian Job, also with Charlize Theron, also with Jason Statham, and he also directed last year's Straight Outta Compton. I'm not entirely sure if he is a really good fit for this type of material. You watch Straight Outta Compton, and that's sort of like this really, you know, it had like a sort of a gritty verisimilitude as a musical biopic, and I'm just he just seems like an ill fit for this movie, and I don't think he really harnesses the film's action scenes really, really well. Especially with the fight sequences, I mean, they're edited to hyperactive overkill, and you know, he has this really nasty habit of framing him in tight close-ups, so you know, he really needs to pull the camera back and let us, you know, feed on the action sequences themselves, and he really doesn't do that here. So there are some real large-scale action sequences though that do work. One in particular involves Charlize Theron's character using her super hacker abilities to basically hack into hundreds of smart cars in New York City and basically turned them into zombified cars that attacked the heroes.
No one's ready for this.
She's the very definition of high-tech terrorism.
There's thousands of cars in this city, and now they're all mine.
Is it preposterous? Yes. Is it exhilarating? Absolutely.
Wait!
And then, of course, the film culminates in this massive sequence in Russia. Don't ask me why they go to Russia. Don't ask me why it involves a submarine.
Oh, shit! We're gonna need a bigger truck!
Or torpedoes, or tanks, or Lamborghinis.
Why are they shooting at me?
I don't know, maybe because you're in an orange Lamborghini?
Shut up, Ted!
It's a lot of dumb fun. And it really defies the laws of physics, because clearly the makers of this film have never driven cars on the snow and ice covered roads of Saskatchewan, because cars can't do what this film says they can do. This film's tone is really kind of all over the map. I mean, it certainly embraces its rampant preposterousness and its ludicrousness. But nevertheless, it also contains a handful of scenes where the film sort of takes itself as serious as a heart attack. And I think that at times it really creates this odd disconnect in the film.
I think I need to remind you why you chose to be here.
I got no choice!
And then, of course, there's some really odd plot developments. Like, Jason Statham's character shows up in the film. And a few films ago, he was murdered, death, killing members of Dom's group. And now he's this happy-go-lucky character that's teaming up with his crew. Like, I'm like, what?
You want to tell me why you just put me in a room with this tea and crumpets eating criminal?
You know, I think that tight t-shirt's cutting up the circulation of your brain. You should get a bigger size.
You guys are gonna work together.
Love to.
And I found that the film, no pun intended, was kind of spinning its wheels a little too leisurely in terms of its plot. I didn't think that there was any forward progression for any of the characters in this film the way that I think that it really should have had. I found the film more exhausting than energizing and fun. And you know, the film is, you know, pushing 2.5 hours, and it is way, way too long for its own good, and I think that really hurts its pacing.
I don't know if the old Dom is in there. I don't give a damn. I'm taking you down. Toretto, let's play.
As much as I have admired and been an apologist of the Fast and the Furious franchise over the last 17 years, I think my willingness to defend the Fate and the Furious and this entry in the series is kind of waning. And I think it's the warning signs are there that the series is frankly running out of a little bit of gas.
This can't be happening, man.
There you go. There's my review of the Fate of the Furious. Let me know in the comments below what you thought of the film. Also, let me know in the comments below what you think your favorite Fast and the Furious film is. Thank you very much for watching. If you could like this review, I'd really, really appreciate it. If you could subscribe to my channel, give me some subscribe love. That would mean the world to me. Take care, everybody, and I'll see you at the movies.